This conference will now be recorded.
Okay. Okay, so today we are going to discuss the topic of acute traumatic fever. The old saying is there that acute traumatic fever that it hits the joints and bites the heart. So it is more of entity, the more serious thing is the carditis part. So to continue with this topic, first of all, we'll go through the introduction part and the definition of all these things. So coming to the acute traumatic fever, it is a systemic disease of childhood and it is most common acquired heart disease also. Usually follows the infection that is caused by group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection. And you all know that it is a diffuse infection. So it is a diffuse inflammatory disease of connective tissue, primarily involving the heart, blood vessels, joints, subcutaneous tissue, and central nervous system. You may ask, why, madam, all these things? Like heart, why, blood vessels, why joints, why subcutaneous tissue? Because some molecular mimicry is there where it produces antibodies against these things. So we are going to discuss that part during the pathogenesis. So a brief introduction that it is a systemic disease. It involves many organs, mainly the heart, and all others are like blood vessels, joints, subcutaneous tissue, and central nervous system. And it usually follows a group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection. It is one of the non-suppurative complication of the group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection that is followed by pharyngitis rather than the skin infection. So coming to the epidemiology part, what is the age group that most commonly affects? The age group is around 5 to 15 years of age. You should unlikely to see at the age group of less than 3 years. Some books says there is no like sex predilection, both it is common in both males, equally females. But some says girls are more affected than boys. It is common in third world countries. What are the environmental factors that play a role that to cause an acute traumatic fever? It's like for routine upper respiratory tract infections, the same like overcrowding, any poor sanitation, poverty. And one more thing, that incidence is more during fall, winter, and early spring seasons. So till now we discussed what is the peak age, what is the definition, and what are the environmental factors that causes this rheumatic fever. And one more thing, usually with rheumatic fever, we can see always a serological evidence of recent group A streptococcal infection. Till now we discussed that group A streptococcal infection, pharyngitis followed by this non-suppurative complication of acute traumatic fever. So usually these titers are seen more in a complicated disease rather than uncomplicated streptococcal infections. Okay, so one more thing you must remember, that not all the serotypes are responsible for the rheumatic fever. So only some serotypes. Why serotype is particularly important, that's why I'm repeating, because the particular serotypes are rheumatogenic. So the concept of rheumatogenicity is generally supported by the observation that all those serotypes of group A streptococcal infection frequently associated with skin infection can be isolated also from the upper respiratory tract, but usually they doesn't cause any recurrences of rheumatic fever or the cause of rheumatic fever. So rheumatogenicity is important, that's why serotypes are very important. Which serotype causes this particular cause of acute rheumatic fever? Usually skin infection causing serotypes are not that rheumatogenic to cause this acute rheumatic fever. So one must remember what is the organism that is causing this particular entity of acute rheumatic fever, and what are the serotypes that are responsible for this acute rheumatic fever, because serotype indirectly indicates what is the rheumatogenicity. So not all the serotypes are particularly harmful to the heart, right? So coming to the pathogenesis, you all know this is an immune response. So molecular memory, mimicry, antigen antibody complexes. So it is of like immunological mediated response. So delayed immune response to infection that we already discussed this repeated times, that is group A beta hemolytic streptococcus. What happens is after a latent period of 1 to 3 weeks, Antibody induced immunological damage occurred to the heart valves, joints, subcutaneous tissues, and basal ganglia of the brain. That's why chorea occurs. This is the reason, because it involves the basal ganglia of the brain. Why heart? Because it involves heart valves, joints, that involves arthritis, and subcutaneous tissue, resulting in subcutaneous nodules and all the things. So almost all the major criteria is fitting over here, right? Like carditis, arthritis, subcutaneous nodules, erythema marginatum, and chorea. So in this particular way, you can write the retrospectively even the pathogenesis, if, or you can summarize the major criteria depending upon the system is involved. So next thing is, till now we discussed. So what are the strains, or what are the serotypes that produces rheumatic fever? Exactly is serotypes 1, 3, 5, 6, 18, and 24. So pharyngitis produced by group A beta hemolytic streptococci can lead to acute rheumatic fever, rheumatic heart disease, and post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. And we already discussed skin infection produced by this organism leads to post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis only. It will not result in rheumatic fever or carditis. That's where rheumatogenicity of particular serotype is important. So whenever you are mentioning like pathogenesis, you have to write the serotypes and you have to write the rheumatogenicity thing a bit. So it will be easy. So till now, what we discussed, I hope I am clear. If at all any disturbance or any problem is there with my voice or any doubts, you can ask me at any point. So this is epidemiology part, introduction part, and all the serotypes and everything. So coming to the, till now we discussed this organism like group A beta hemolytic streptococcus. What exactly it contains? You all know this is a more of microbiology part, but one must understand. So antigen of the outer protein cell wall of group A beta hemolytic streptococcus induces antibody response in victim, which resulting autoimmune damage. So the molecular memory mimicry is more with the antigen of the protein cell wall. So resulting in autoimmune damage to heart valves, subcutaneous tissue. It's the same thing like basal ganglia of brain, tendons, and joints. Coming to the pathogenesis part, till now we discussed epidemiology and pathogenesis also, like only the one part I told is the latent period is so high and it is immune damage resulting in all this. So for everything, there will be established theories, right? Why this happens? Why like this only it is happening? So some three theories are there. The most accepted theory is immune-mediated pathogenesis, but other theories also you must know. One is cytotoxic theory that suggests that group A streptococcal toxin involved in the pathogenesis of acute rheumatic fever and rheumatic heart disease is that group A streptococcus produces a number of enzymes. So that organism produces a number of enzymes like streptolysin O. What happens is that it is cytotoxic, but in culture, they appreciated like cytotoxicity for mammalian cardiac cells, which has direct cytotoxic effect. But this theory is that doesn't explain why this latent period of like taking substantial latent period of around 10 to 21 days, right? Because even the next day of pharyngitis, we don't get any rheumatic fever. Some time is taking. If at all this cytotoxic theory is correct, immediate tissue damage, immediately we need to produce some symptoms, right? So initially, the first theory that came to know is a cytotoxic theory. But so many things are like unclear why the latency period. Then came the second theory called as immune-mediated pathogenesis, both for acute rheumatic fever and rheumatic heart disease. And the same thing, immune-mediated pathogenesis, that is the antigenicity of several group A streptococcal cellular and extracellular epitopes and their immunological cross-reactivity with the cardiac antigenic epitopes also lends support to the hypothesis of molecular mimicry. So the common epitopes that are shared between the organism, that is group A beta hemolytic streptococcal, is like M protein, cell membrane, group A cell wall carbohydrate and capsular hyaluronate, and specific mammalian tissues like heart valve, sarcolemma, brain and joint. So for example, like certain rheumatogenic M proteins share their epitopes with the human myocardial proteins. What are the human myocardial proteins? You know, like tropomyosin and myosin. So this is the molecular mimicry sharing with the organism as well as with the human myocardial proteins. So this is the immune mediated response resulting in the damage. So another one more thing is binding of an M protein N terminus domain to a region of collagen type 4 leads to an antibody response to the collagen, resulting in ground substance inflammation, especially in the subendothelial areas like cardiac valves and the myocardium. I know it is a bit confusing, but whenever you have to write or mention regarding pathogenesis, we have to remember that these three theories. Important is immune-mediated pathogenesis. That's where this latency, it will take that time of 10 to 21 days to produce this acute rheumatic fever. And this is the most accepted theory why this particular rheumatogenicity and why this particular rheumatic fever. I hope I am clear. So till now, we discussed only the introduction, epidemiology, and pathogenesis. I hope I am clear. And this is the same thing. So pharyngitis followed by this immunological response resulting in the diseases with like acute rheumatic disease because of the cross-reactivity with the antibodies. See, first of all, I want to tell this criteria before going to explain all these things that are entities that are present in the criteria, because you see, the Ducker-Jones criteria proposed guidelines like around 1944, revised, and this is the modified, revised or revised Jones criteria by American Heart Association in 2015. This is the recent one. Previously, I think you also know like all these major criteria and minor criteria. Now, recent terms called like the low risk population and high risk population came across because to substantially increase the that how to diagnose, to how to identify the rheumatic fever, because so many unidentified cases of rheumatic fever are still there. That's why to pinpoint and to get more accuracy regarding the diagnosis, all these criteria were come like low risk population. So to define some criteria in low risk and to particularly specify some in high risk population and all those things. So before going to the criteria per se, you have to know what is the low risk population and what is the moderate or high risk population according to this revised Jones criteria. The low risk population is instance of less than 2 per 1 lakh poor age children per year, or all age of rheumatic heart diseases prevalence is less than 1 per 1000 population. So you call it this as low risk. Moderate or high risk, when do you call it as moderate or high risk population, is that those with higher incidence or prevalence rates. So I think I'm clear what is low risk, what is high risk. So depending upon that, we have a criteria for low risk population, carditis, clinical or subclinical carditis. We'll go later on what is clinical or what is subclinical carditis. One is, and a brief point I'll give, clinical carditis that we can appreciate some murmur or something. But in subclinical carditis, we cannot see clinically, but there will be an echocardiography finding, so we cannot ignore. So carditis comes both. We have to include both clinical as well as subclinical. So the next is arthritis. In low risk population, we cannot take single bone or single joint involved. Only polyarthritis we have to consider. Next is chorea, erythema marginatum, and subcutaneous nodules. The high risk population the same. The criteria will not change, but the only thing is arthritis. Only we should not consider polyarthritis. Even we need to consider monoarthritis as well. And also polyarthralgia. This is the difference. In a low risk population, only polyarthritis will be the criteria. In a high risk population where prevalence of rheumatic fever is more, even we need to consider single joint involvement as well as arthralgia rather than arthritis. So this is the difference in major criteria in between low risk and high risk population. Coming to the minor criteria, the same thing. In high risk population, even a single monoarthralgia we have to take, and hyperpyrexia of more than 38 degrees centigrade. In low risk, 38.5 degrees centigrade. And the markers of inflammatory markers like ESR of more than 60 mm per hour in a low risk, and CRP of more than 3 we need to consider in low risk. But in high risk, we have to be very cautious, like ESR of more than 30 we have to consider, and CRP of more than 3 we need to consider. And prolonged PR interval is both the same. So I hope you're understanding why the cutoffs are less in a high risk population, because the prevalence is more. We cannot go on thinking that all these things like polyarthralgia. That's why we are narrowing ourselves like to identify more appropriately the cases of rheumatic fever. This low risk and high risk came across. Okay. So whenever in the next subsequent questions, you need to write this Jones revised criteria, not the old criteria, like simply like these five major and four minor criteria. You have to write everything depending upon the risk of population, whether it is low risk or whether it is high risk. So we already discussed what is low risk population, what is high risk population. So categorizing is not enough. When do we call it as an attack? And when do we call it as a recurrent or an acute thing? So first attack, either two major manifestations or one major and two minor manifestation plus evidence of recent group A streptococcal infection to diagnose for a first attack. Then when we call it as a recurrence, two major or one major and two minor plus evidence of recent group A streptococcal infection. And for a recurrence, in a moderate or high risk population, we need to consider even three minor manifestations plus evidence of recent group A streptococcal infection, we need to consider. So these are the clinical manifestations, same thing we discussed. But why this diagrammatic representation is, when it is occurring, see the polyarthritis, it comes initial days followed by carditis, erythema marginatum, it doesn't have any peak or resolving like around 1 to 2 months. Chorea, it is usually a late presentation. Usually with chorea, we need not be always like to find out the group A streptococcal infection because titus will be going on reducing, right? And the subcutaneous nodules, these are also like months together. So coming to the carditis part. So till now we discussed polyarthritis, carditis, erythema marginatum, chorea and subcutaneous nodules. So major criteria we are discussing is carditis. Endocarditis must be there. And remaining like pericarditis and myocarditis, which is a variable presentation. Carditis incidence varies from 50 to 60%. The clinical diagnosis of carditis is an index attack of rheumatic fever based on the presence of significant murmurs, pericardial drop, unexplained cardiomegaly with congestive cardiac failure. I already discussed carditis can be clinical or subclinical. So clinical carditis, you can see all the clinical features of like the murmurs you can hear, congestive cardiac failure you can see like edema, dyspnea, distress and all these things. So usually occur in a young child that you already know because the age before presentation is 5 to 15 years. So 80% of patients develop it within first 2 weeks of rheumatic fever. That is the thing here. We projected the carditis when it will occur between 0 and 1 month. So we already discussed endocarditis is a must. If the child is having pericarditis and myocarditis without any valvular involvement, we have to think the other diagnosis rather than rheumatic fever. So coming to the carditis, we already discussed, right? So valve involvement, what is the valve that is most commonly involved? It is the mitral valve. 92 to 95% of isolated mitral valve is involved, followed by aortic valve. Usually aortic valve involvement without mitral valve is very rare. So you already know, what is the mitral regurgitation murmur? It is a pansystolic murmur in apex radiating to axilla with more than grade 3. Most common finding in carditis. Aortic regurgitation in the absence of mitral regurgitation is uncommon. So one thing you should remember, carditis, it can be clinical or subclinical. Any clinical presentation of valvular involvement like regurgitations, murmurs, we have to think. If at all there is no involvement of valves or there is no involvement of endocarditis and only presence of peri or myocarditis, we have to think likely other diagnosis. Mitral regurgitation is the common lesion that you see in a carditis case of rheumatic fever. So this you need not remember much more, but if the patient is already having a previous rheumatic heart disease, a definitive change in the character of any of these murmurs or appearance of a new significant murmur, you can consider it is a recurrence, or you have to think whether the child got one more episode of acute rheumatic fever or recurrence. So pathogenesis, what you see in a severe mitral regurgitation is valvulitis, mitral annular dilatation, leaflet prolapse with or without caudal elongation, caudal rupture. And one more thing, like acute rheumatic carditis usually presents with like any carditis, how it will present like tachycardia, cardiac murmurs. And I already told you with or without myocardial or pericardial involvement. So what is pericarditis? So if at all very rare, like 6 to 15% of rheumatic fever cases are only presenting with pericarditis, diagnosed by typical pain and friction rub, always associated with rheumatic valvulitis, may be associated with normal ECG, may be associated with effusion, but rarely causes constriction and tamponade. And one more thing you remember, this is the very rare presentation of a rheumatic fever with pericarditis. Most common thing is like endocarditis, usually presents with tachycardia, cardiac murmurs, with or without evidence of all these things. And I already told you, mitral valve is the most common valve involved, followed by aortic valve. isolated aortic valve is very unlikely without mitral valve involvement. And one more thing, endocarditis is universal finding in rheumatic arthritis. So these are more than enough for you people to remember and to write. So subclinical carditis is already discussed in the carditis part. When you come across like subclinical carditis, what is subclinical? I already told, defined as without a murmur of valvulitis but with echocardiographic evidence of valvulitis. So on clinical examination we cannot find any murmur. That also we have to consider. That is the major part in revised Jones criteria. Clinical carditis, that is you already can have a probable diagnosis because of the valvulitis murmur. You can appreciate when you listen with your stethoscope, right? So what are the echocardiographic findings of subclinical carditis? Means, so subclinical, only echocardiographic, already discussed. Seen at least two views. We have to see in a two views. And jet length of more than 2 cm in at least one view, peak velocity of more than 3 m/s, pan systolic jet in at least one envelope. You have to mug up here. I cannot explain you more than this. You have to remember all these 4 points to call it as a subclinical carditis, that echocardiographic findings meeting all these 4 points. Already discussed, endocarditis is a universal finding of rheumatic carditis. So one more thing is valvular insufficiency, that is valvular involvement of endocarditis, characteristic of both acute as well as convalescent stages of acute rheumatic fever. But mitral and stenosis, you can see regurgitation in initial stages, but stenosis usually appears years or even decades after the acute illness. That is not a acute manifestation of valvular insufficiency, the stenosis. Next is coming to arthritis. See, mostly 75% of acute rheumatic fever typically presents with polyarthritis. It usually involves larger joints, particularly the knees, ankles, wrists, and elbows. Involvement of like spine, small joints of hands and feet or hips is uncommon. So arthritis, rheumatic fever usually involves the large joints rather than a small joint. That is a one thing. One more thing is like rheumatic joints are usually classically hot, red, swollen, and tender. Usually, even a friction of bed clothes being uncomfortable to the patient, it is a severe, like, painful condition. Usually, the pain can proceed and can appear to be disproportionate to the objective findings. We cannot correlate sometimes. The pain will be too severe. And one more thing is the joint pain is migratory. That is a typical of arthritis in rheumatic fever. So, first of all, one joint involves within 1 to 3 days, the joint will become normal. So followed by other joint. So this migratory nature, like one joint involving, regressing, and followed by another joint involving. In sometimes severe arthritis may be present for years, but never be deforming. Like this arthritis caused by rheumatic fever will be never deforming thing. It will not any cause deformities to the patient. And one more thing, polyarthritis is typical, monoarthritis is usual and unlikely. And one more thing, in this particular type of arthritis caused by rheumatic fever, it is dramatic response to salicylates we can see. So that's why initially we don't give treatment with salicylate because we need to observe the migratory nature of the polyarthritis, whether individual joint is there or not, or migratory nature is there or not. If at all this arthritis is not responding to salicylate, one must consider the other diagnosis, because tremendous or dramatic response to salicylates for this polyarthritis is seen in case of rheumatic fever. And whenever you see you aspirate any synovial fluid in a case of acute rheumatic fever, it usually contains 10,000 to 1 lakh WBC, and it contains normal glucose and but neutrophilic predominance we can see, and the protein is approximately 4 g/dL. It usually self-limiting and normalizes by 2 to 4 weeks. Usually that doesn't require any treatment apart from symptomatic treatment like rest and hot fermentation and salicylates and NSAIDs. That's all. That is more than enough. And one more thing, polyarthritis and Sydenham's chorea never occur simultaneously. And one more thing, there is an inverse relationship between the severity of arthritis and cardiac involvement. So we already discussed in this. I already told you polyarthritis in high and low risk populations like polyarthralgia, monoarthritis we have to take as a major criteria in a high risk or medium risk population. Even monoarthralgia in a high risk population is a minor criteria. This already we discussed, and we have to write all those extra points in your examination. next is subcutaneous nodules, usually very rare, less than 1% in patients with acute rheumatic fever. And it is like firm nodules, approximately 0.5 to 2 centimeter diameter, usually occurs along the extensor surfaces. And there is a correlation that presence of these nodules and significant rheumatic heart disease one is to expect. These are the subcutaneous nodules. Next is erythema marginatum. This is a characteristic rash of acute rheumatic fever. It consists of erythematous epiginous macular lesions with the pale centers, and these are not pruritic, so these are not itchy lesions. Multiple lesions primarily on the trunk or proximal extremities, rarely on distal extremities or never on face, and these are accentuated by warming the skin. It is not associated with carditis. Nodules and marginatum can occur simultaneously, and some other conditions where you can say erythema marginatum is in sepsis, drug reactions, and glomerulonephritis. These are the lesions with central pallor and serpiginous ulcer, which are non-itchy and almost never occur on a face and usually occurs in extremities. This picture explains everything. Coming to the chorea. So chorea occurs in 10 to 15% of patients, roughly around 5 to 36% in acute rheumatic fever. Also called as situitis dans, most commonly seen in females. It is usually an isolated, frequently subtle neurological behavioral disorder. Emotional liability, incoordination, poor school performance, uncontrollable movements, and facial grimacing can be seen. Exacerbated by stress and disappears with the sleep. This is the characteristic of this thing. Chorea already discussed in a clinical features. It is a late manifestation. It can occur even after months together. That's why we cannot see any antecedent evidence or titers may not correlate with this chorea clinical manifestation. That is the thing I want to explain, that the latent period from group A streptococcal infection is to chorea is usually substantially longer than for arthritis or carditis and can be months. So rheumatic chorea, marker of future carditis. And chorea is rarely associated with polyarthritis. And one more thing I already discussed, inflammatory markers and titers may be normal in this. And in this chorea, I need to tell some maneuvers. Got to add in this, right? So sorry for that inconvenience. One is, you already know rheumatic chorea. One is demonstration of milkmaid's grip. That is irregular contractions and relaxation of muscles of the fingers while squeezing the examiner's finger. That is one point. Spooning and pronation of hands when the patient's arms are extended. This is next one. Or darting movements of the tongue on protrusion, you can see. That is also typical for rheumatic chorea. Examination of handwriting to evaluate fine motor movements. These are the four things that you have to look in a rheumatic chorea patient. Usually, chorea diagnosis is clinical rather than supportive evidence of all these titers and all those things. Because of the long latency period, we cannot see these markers to be elevated. Chorea, long latency period, one must remember, more common in females. Emotional liabilities all will be there. And it is disappearing with the sleep and exacerbated by stress. And the four things I already discussed is starting motility or milkmaid's grip, and spooning and pronation of hands when tongue on protrusion, darting movements of the tongue on protrusion, examination of handwriting to evaluate fine motor movements. Coming to the minor criteria, what are the things that minor criteria is like already discussed? Fever, arthralgias, laboratory findings like elevated ESR, C-reactive protein, prolonged PR interval that you can see in ECG, and already discussed the differences between high risk and low risk population in my previous slides. So one important thing is recent group A streptococcal infection. This is supporting evidence. This is along with this only we complete our criteria, like two major criteria, one major plus two minor criteria with along with antecedent evidence of this group A streptococcal infection. So what is this antecedent evidence of a group A streptococcal infection is like, we all know acute rheumatic fever, the latency period of 10 to 21 days after an acute episode of this pharyngitis. And when clinical pharyngitis usually no longer present, and when only 20 to 20% of patients still harbor this group A streptococcal infection in the throat. This is not due to the acute organism or pathogen. This is immune mediated response for that particular pharyngitis, right? One more thing. So many patients cannot recollect this mild throat infection. So one third of patients, we cannot even get a history of antecedent pharyngitis. So usually we detect antibodies. against all these five group A streptococcal antigens. One easy thing is that it's easy to perform and simple to perform, and it is widely available, but it is not a diagnostic test of this rheumatic fever. This is only substantiating or supporting evidence. So elevated titers one must see. So only single antibody titer, it is not reliable. It is mostly raised. So we have to check for at least of three antibodies, that is anti-streptolysin O, anti-DNase B, and anti-hyaluronidase. So when acute rheumatic fever is suspected clinically, multiple antibody tests should be performed. The exceptions for this is only chorea. Usually that does not correlate with these streptococcal titers. So the clinical findings of acute rheumatic fever generally remaining all coincide with the peak anti-streptococcal antibody responses, except the chorea. So we cannot meet only with this. If the child is not meeting the other criteria of Jones, like major and minor criteria, the streptococcal ASO titers are positive, we cannot label it as this thing. And if the child is having chorea, and if you are not expecting this streptococcal disease, we cannot deny that it is a rheumatic fever. So these are the two important differences one must remember in treating or in diagnosing the rheumatic fever. So these are the differential diagnoses of rheumatic fever. Because of the varied presentation, arthritis, carditis, and chorea. So what are the conditions that you come across, like arthritis, is like juvenile idiopathic arthritis? In this, how will you differentiate means, it usually tends to be younger age group and less joint pain comparative to the acute rheumatic fever. And also we cannot see other findings of rheumatic fever in a juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Reactive arthritis, in this you can see like spiking fevers, lymphadenopathy, splenomegaly, and all those things. Serum sickness, systemic lupus erythematosus, multisystem involvement, Lyme's disease, usually monoarthritis, pyogenic arthritis, and post-streptococcal reactive arthritis. These are the differential diagnoses. For a carditis, viral myocarditis, pericarditis, infective endocarditis, Kawasaki disease, mitral valve prolapse, innocent murmurs, and congenital heart disease. Coming to the chorea part, Huntington's chorea, Wilson's disease, cerebral palsy, tic disorder, and hyperactivity. So in these conditions, we come across chorea, but there are such differentiating points will be so many, it will be too exhaustive to explain all those things. So you remember some points or some differential diagnosis for this acute rheumatic fever. So coming to the treatment, so how do you want to treat the patient now? Hope I am clear. I'm not giving any gap for you people. Am I audible and clear? Any doubts are there till now? Hello, am I clear? Please someone talk, at least for a minute. Am I clear or not? Just say yes or no. Am I clear?
Yes, yes ma'am.
Shall I continue? I'm a bit fast because time is less, that's why. Okay, continue. So coming to the treatment part. Till now we discussed the criteria, Jones, high risk population, low risk population, what is the epidemiology, what is the age group, what are the clinical manifestations and individual things and all this. So ultimately we need to treat the patient, right? The thing is first important is rest. You have to give the rest because any congestive cardiac failure or anything, you need to give rest, right? For carditis. And you need to watch carefully for the evidence of carditis. So they can be allowed to ambulate when the signs of inflammation have improved. And usually if the patient is having carditis, this bed rest prolonged is usually prolonged. So next is aspirin. This is anti-inflammatory therapy. But it should be withheld only if having arthralgia or atypical arthritis is the only clinical manifestation of acute rheumatic fever. Why we have to withheld these aspirin or salicylates to confirm the migratory nature of the arthritis. When it is debilitating the pain or anything, we can give with the treatment. So the dose, how do you divide the dose? It is 50 to 70 mg per kg per day in divided doses for 3 to 5 days, followed by 50 mg per kg per day per oral for 3 weeks. And out of that half dose, this is 25 mg per kg per day for another 2 to 4 weeks. In this, you have to remember initial dose followed by low doses for around 3 weeks. And then you have to taper. We cannot abruptly stop the drugs. Rebound pain will be there. So when will we give this is patients with typical migratory polyarthritis and those with carditis without cardiomegaly or congestive cardiac failure should be treated with oral salicylates. So this is the thing. So only the child will be having arthritis without any, and those with carditis but without any evidence of congestive cardiac failure features or something, then we go with only salicylates. With oral salicylates, usually you all know NSAID toxicity, like tinnitus and everything may happen, but we need not check the levels of salicylate by giving this treatment during this period, and local measure one should take. So next is carditis alone, the same thing, aspirin. Carditis with cardiomegaly, aspirin only. Carditis with congestive cardiac failure, here comes the steroids role. So when everyone will get a doubt, when will we use steroids? The only man when we give steroids is like with carditis with congestive cardiac failure, then we go with steroids. The steroids also the same thing, we need to tap it. The dose is 2 to 0.5 mg/kg/day, intubated doses for 2 to 3 weeks, and then taper slowly over 2 to 3 weeks. If the child develops congestive cardiac failure, then one must go with decongestive measures like diuretics and all those things. Bed rest and low sodium diet one should follow. And one more thing, when we are tapering the prednisolone or steroid, aspirin should be started at 50 mg/kg/day in 4 divided doses for 6 weeks to prevent rebound inflammation. So carditis with congestive cardiac failure, we start with steroids. During the tapering process of steroid, we need to add aspirin at the dose of 50 mg/kg/day for 6 weeks to prevent this rebound inflammation, acute rheumatic fever. Then one, that one must remember. So what happens is with the termination of anti-inflammatory therapy may be followed by reappearance of all the clinical manifestations or elevation of ESR and CRP rebound. It may be prudent to increase salicylates or corticosteroids until near normalization of all our inflammatory markers that we already discussed, like CRP and ESR. Next is chorea. Usually, chorea is an isolated manifestation, occurs after the resolution of acute phase of a disease. So usually, we don't require any inflammatory agents. Why? Because all the inflammation got come down. This is that doesn't correlate with the acute inflammation. Months after this manifestation may occur. So in this point, only we need to treat chorea rather than all those inflammatory things like prednisolone, salicylates, and everything. So here the drugs are three. Phenobarbital, that is barbiturate. The dose is 15 to 30 mg/kg/day in 3 divided doses. Another one is haloperidol, antipsychotic, 0.01 to 0.03 mg/kg/day in 2 divided doses. Clotrimazole, 0.5 mg/kg, 6 hourly orally. And steroids in some cases. So anti-streptococcal regimen, why do we use? Because to eradicate that organism and to prevent that, it is more of like a primary prevention. Already the child got a pharyngitis with that infection, and but that to prevent that at that point, not to get traumatic fever, that is the prophylaxis. There we can use the anti-streptococcal regimen, that is phenoxymethyl penicillin. The dose is like children with more than body weight of 40 kilos, 2 to 3 million international units in 2 divided doses every 12 hours for 10 days. Less than 40 kilos, 1 lakh to 2 lakh international units per kg per day in 2 divided doses every 12 hours for 10 days. Another one more is benzoyl penicillin intramuscularly, more than 40 kilos, 1.2 million international units, less than 40 kilos, it is 6 lakh international units. So there are like primordial prevention, primary prevention, secondary prevention, tertiary. Primordial, the vaccine or something, we cannot take. Or community prevention. Primary prevention, what is streptococcal pharyngitis? Before the start of symptoms, like within 9 days, we have to start with this prophylaxis, because 50% of chances of a group A streptococcal pharyngitis getting this chance of rheumatic fever. So at that point, we can prevent the disease to occur. Coming, what is with secondary prevention is that in why we are giving after acute rheumatic fever, we are giving depending upon the carditis thing, depending upon all the other clinical features, we are giving years together the prophylaxis of penicillin. Why? To prevent recurrences of rheumatic fever, that is called a secondary prevention. So in primary prevention, one can do what is means appropriate antibiotic therapy should instituted before 9th day of symptoms of acute group A streptococcal pharyngitis is highly effective in preventing first attacks of acute rheumatic fever. However, approximately 30% of patients with acute rheumatic fever do not recall a preceding episode of pharyngitis and did not seek therapy. So primary prophylaxis is helpful when we institute the treatment before 9th day of symptoms of this group A streptococcal pharyngitis. It is a bit difficult, but one can try. The dose The drugs are available are oral penicillin, erythromycin, first generation cephalosporin, azithromycin. And parenterally is less than 27 kilos, single intramuscular dose of benzene penicillin, more than 27 kilos, IM benzene penicillin of 1.2 lakh internet, 12 million units, sorry. So coming to the secondary prevention. So secondary prevention is directed at preventing acute Group A streptococcal pharyngitis in patients at substantial risk of recurrent acute rheumatic fever. Secondary prevention usually requires continuous antibiotic prophylaxis and we should begin as soon as the diagnosis of acute rheumatic fever has been made and immediately after a full course of antibiotic therapy has been completed. So this is the prevention of recurrences. So we need to give continuous antibiotic prophylaxis. So before patients who have had carditis with their initial episode of acute rheumatic fever at a higher risk of having carditis and recurrences and substantiating additional cardiac damage, so they should require lifelong long-term antibiotic prophylaxis well into adulthood and perhaps for life sometimes. So these are the drugs, the same thing. Rheumatic fever without carditis usually requires 5 years or until 21 years of age. With carditis, but without any residual heart disease, 10 years or 21 years of age, whichever is longer. With evidence of carditis, like any valvular damage is there, usually lifelong antibiotic prophylaxis is required for those. So it also divided into again three entities, the secondary prevention, like without carditis, with carditis, with carditis with valvular involvement, depending upon the duration of treatment, go on increasing, right? So rheumatic fever, it is like community acquired disease and acquired heart disease. To some extent, it is a preventable disease. But the environmental things like primordial prevention is typical. Primary prevention with accurate history or before the onset of symptoms with Group A streptococcal pharyngitis, we can reduce. Secondary prevention is nothing but all those things. So these are the drugs and prophylaxis. Coming to the prognosis. So what is the prognosis we expect? Before antibiotic prophylaxis, 75% of patients develop recurrences and residual heart diseases. 50 to 70% with carditis during initial episode recover with no residual disease. Severe the initial attack, more chances of rheumatic heart disease. So what is the initial attack? So we can counsel the parents regarding what could be the prognosis in future of rheumatic heart disease. When the initial attack is itself severe, there are more chances of rheumatic heart disease. Risk of recurrences are more in the first 5 years of clinical episode. So more the duration, the lesser will be the risk. So within the first few years of initial episode, there are chances of recurrences are more. So 20% of patients with pure chorea, not given a secondary prophylaxis, rheumatic heart disease may develop within 20 years. So this is the prognosis part that one can explain to the parent. So to summarize my topic, the starting thing we all discussed is definition, multisystem involvement, what is the age group, what is the latency period, what is the pathogenesis, that is immunological mediated disease, more of acute rheumatic fever. And 2015 revised Jones criteria, that is like major criteria and minus criteria, high risk population, low risk population. And all these major criteria and individual importance of all those things. And one more thing, I think you found it is new is subclinical carditis and all the thing. And one more thing is chorea that doesn't correlate with antistreptococcal antibody titers. This is Jones criteria. And the management part, exactly what happens with the management is one is bed rest and another one is antibiotics and next one is prophylaxis. And if at all the child is having congestive cardiac failure or all the things, so anti-decongestive measures, digoxin and diuretics are helpful. So this is the summary of the topic of acute rheumatic fever. Hope I am clear. Any doubts, you can ask me. Roll number 102, are you there? Am I clear? Am I clear? She's still yes or no? I cannot see even your faces, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, any doubts at any point? This is like more of you need to memorize all these criteria because usually the common question for people is own criteria only. ओके, एवरीवन गेव योर अटेंडेंस इन दैट चैट बॉक्स इट ऑल नो जस्ट गो एंड गिव इट. Okay. Any doubt? Shall I leave the meeting? Shall I end the meeting?
Yes.